Hello students, I am Jitendra Chahal and I am present in front of you with a new video from class 10th, the first flight book, chapter 3, two stories about flying. And today we are going to study the second part of this chapter, and that is the Blake aeroplane. This is the second part of this chapter, and the first part that we already have understood, and that was his first flight. Okay, that I already have explained to you, and we have studied that. Now today we'll study this one, the Blake aeroplane, second part, right? So just after this, the Blake aeroplane. Now, what is a Blake aeroplane? A Blake aeroplane can be painted in black, it can be in black color, okay? But what is a Blake aeroplane in this story, that we'll come to know after going through this story, okay? So let's start with this. This is the story of a pilot, his courage, his determination, and his patience, right? Now, let's start with this. The moon was coming up in the east behind me, and stars were shining in the clear sky above me, okay? The moon was coming up, it was rising up behind the narrator, behind the writer, okay? That means the moon was coming in the east, coming up in the east. That means the narrator or the writer was moving in which direction? West, okay, because if the moon is behind, okay, and behind the direction is east, that means the front direction will be west. So the writer or the narrator was heading ahead or heading towards the west direction now, and the sky was also very clear. There were stars in the sky, okay. He could see, the weather was clear at that time, okay. There wasn't a cloud in the sky. I was happy to be along high above the sleeping countryside, okay. And at that time the weather was very clear. The narrator is saying that the weather was very clear, and the narrator was very happy to fly in the sky, okay, over the sleeping countryside. You can see this is the countryside, and the aeroplane is flying over this city, sleeping city or sleeping countryside. Now, I was flying my old Dakota aeroplane over France back to England, and the narrator was flying the aeroplane. What narrator was flying, that aeroplane's name was Dakota, okay. So he was flying the old Dakota, okay, over the France. At that time he was over France, means he was flying over the country France now, and he was going towards England. He was going from France to England. Now, I was dreaming of my holiday and looking forward to being with my family. And the narrator was dreaming of his holidays. Actually, he might have got holidays, so he was dreaming about those holidays, how he would spend those holidays with his family. And he was also dreaming about his family, of being with his family. I looked at my watch, 1:30 in the morning. And now, at night, it was the time was 1:30. Morning, why we are saying, because the morning starts from after 12 o'clock from at night, okay. At night after 12 o'clock the morning starts. So it was the time, it was 1:30 in the morning, okay. That means after 12 o'clock, 1:30. Now, I should call Paris control soon, I thought, as I looked down past the nose of the aeroplane. I saw the lights of a big city in front of me. I switched on the radio and said, Paris control, Dakota DS-088 here. Can you hear me? I am on my way to England. Over. Okay, now he decided, the narrator decided to contact to the Paris control. Okay, control, these when you are flying an aeroplane, so you have different centers for controlling the situations, for observing the situations in the sky. So that kind of control tower was there in the or control center was there in the Paris. So he decided to contact the that control center. Okay. And he informed, he tried on the radio and he made a contact with that control, Paris control. And he informed that he was flying Dakota 088. Okay. The voice from the radio answered me immediately, DS-088, I can hear you. You are to turn 12 degree west now, DS-088 over. Okay. And he also got the reply from the control center. And the instruction which was given from the control center was, he was told to turn his aeroplane to turn his aeroplane 12 degree in the west. Okay. This instruction was given to the narrator from the control center. Now, I checked the map and the compass, switched over to my second and last fuel tank and turned the Dakota 12 degree west towards England. Okay. Now, as he was moving ahead towards England, so he turned his aeroplane 12 degree west. And besides this, he also switched from one tank to second fuel tank. Okay, actually there were two fuel tanks in the aeroplane. So one was finished. So he switched to the second fuel tank. Now, I will be in time for breakfast. I thought a good big English breakfast. Everything was going well. It was an easy flight. And now, again, after everything was going on well, so again, he was dreaming about the breakfast that he would have with his family in the morning. Okay. And he was thinking that by the time of breakfast, he would reach there and he would have his breakfast with his family. He thought so. And he loved the English breakfast. The breakfast which is eaten in England, that is known as English breakfast. Right. Indian breakfast, what we have in India, that is Indian breakfast. Okay. So in the same way, the narrator liked English breakfast very much. Obviously, it was his country, so he liked that. Now, I'll be in time. This is over. Paris was about 150 kilometers behind me when I saw the clouds, storm clouds. Now, when he moved 150 kilometers away from Paris, suppose this is the Paris, this is Paris, and when he moved 150 kilometers away from Paris towards England, okay, so at that time he saw huge clouds, storm clouds in the sky. They were huge. They looked like black mountains standing in front of me across the sky. And those clouds were as huge as a mountain. Okay, and those were standing in front of the narrator in the sky. I knew I could not fly up and over them. And I did not have enough fuel to fly around them to the north or south. And narrator very well knew that he could not fly above those clouds, because those were as high as the mountain and as wide also. Okay. So neither he could fly above those clouds nor he could fly around those clouds, because he had limited fuel with him. Okay. That's why he could not fly around nor he could fly above them, above those clouds. Now, I ought to go back to Paris, I thought, but I wanted to get home. I wanted that breakfast. Then for a moment, he decided to go back to Paris. Okay. But his heart said him, or from inside, he was not willing to go back. He was willing to go to his family and he was willing to have that breakfast. He liked that and he was, homesick, right? That's why he decided to go home. I will take the risk, I thought, and flew that old Dakota straight into the storm. And then he decided to take risk and straight he flew his aeroplane into the storm cloud. Inside the clouds, everything was suddenly black. It was impossible to see anything outside the aeroplane. And when he entered into those clouds, so everything was black. He could not see anything out of his aeroplane. Means nothing was visible inside that storm. Okay. Now, the old aeroplane jumped and twisted in the air. I looked at the compass. Okay. I couldn't believe my eyes, the compass was turning round and round and round. Okay, then his aeroplane jumped and twisted in the storm. Okay, and then he searched for his compass. When he saw the compass, he could not believe. Compass, you know, that compass which is used for identifying or indicating the directions. Okay, so when he saw that compass, so its needle was moving round and round. It doesn't happen. Okay, but generally it doesn't happen, but that was happening to the narrator because the compass even was not working properly. Okay, now it was dead. It would not work. The other instruments were suddenly dead too. I tried the radio. Okay, now the compass was dead. The other instrument which were present there on the aeroplane, those were also dead. Then he decided to try on the radio, to get some help from the radio. Now, Paris control, can you hear me? There was no answer. The radio was dead too. When he tried to get some help from the radio, and he called on that radio, Paris control, but he didn't get any answer. That means the radio was also dead. It was also not working. Now, I had no radio, no compass, and I could not see where I was. And the narrator doesn't have anything. The compass was not working, the radio was not working, and he didn't know what was his position in the sky and where he was, right? He didn't know anything about this. I was lost in the storm, then in the black clouds quite near me. And the narrator was totally lost in the sky. Okay. And then in the clouds, he saw, what did he saw? Another aeroplane. Just nearby his aeroplane, he saw another aeroplane. Now, who was that and whose aeroplane was that? Let's see. It had no lights on its wings, but I could see it flying next to me through the storm. I could see the pilot's face turned towards me. I was very glad to see another person. He lifted one hand and waved. Okay. And the narrator saw another aeroplane in the sky, but that aeroplane was totally black and there were no lights on its wings. Okay. He saw the pilot's face was turned. The pilot's face, he saw it was turned towards the narrator. Okay. And then the black aeroplane's pilot, he raised his hand and he waved towards the narrator. This kind of storm was there, storm clouds. You can see as high as the mountain, as wide as the mountain. Okay, just like a mountain. And in this way, the narrator saw another aeroplane in the sky. Okay, now, follow me, he was saying, follow me. And another pilot of that black aeroplane, he told this narrator to follow him. Okay, he knows that I'm lost. I thought he is trying to help me. And the narrator thought that probably that pilot knew the narrator, and that pilot knew that the narrator had lost in that storm. That's why he wanted to help him. He turned his aeroplane slowly to the north, in front of my Dakota, so that it would be easier for me to follow him. And then when one aeroplane, suppose if two aeroplanes are flying side by side, if one aeroplane has moved ahead, overtook this aeroplane, so the black aeroplane turned his aeroplane a little bit, the pilot of the black aeroplane turned his aeroplane a little bit in the north direction, so that this pilot, our narrator, could see, could follow him easily. Now, I was very happy to go behind the strange aeroplane like an obedient child. And the narrator was also very much happy to follow that black aeroplane's pilot, okay, like an obedient child. After half an hour, the strange black aeroplane was still there in front of me in the clouds. And still, after half an hour, when the narrator saw the another aeroplane, it was there in the sky flying along with him, okay, in the clouds. Now, there was only enough fuel in the old Dakota's last tank to fly for 5 or 10 minutes more. Okay, now there was this much fuel in the old Dakota that It could fly only for 5 or 10 minutes. This much fuel was left in the old Dakota's second tank. Okay, now you can see the first tank was over. Now second tank, he switched on the second tank and there also only this much fuel was present so that the narrator could fly the plane up to 5 or 10 minutes only. Now, I was starting to feel frightened again, but then he started to go down and I followed through the storm. Okay, now the narrator, because he saw that the aeroplane could fly only for 5 or 10 minutes, then he started feeling frightened. Okay, but suddenly when he saw that the black aeroplane was going down, okay, so he also followed him. The narrator also followed the black aeroplane. Now, suddenly I came out of the clouds and saw two straight lines of lights in front of me. And suddenly the narrator came out of that storm clouds and then he saw two straight lines of lights. You can see this is the runway. Okay, so the narrator might have seen the runway on the airport. Okay, now, so he was happy that he was out of the storm clouds now. It was a runway and airport. It was a runway. This is called runway and airport. Now, I was safe. The narrator was safe now. Okay, I turned to look for my friend in black aeroplane, but the sky was empty. And then the narrator turned. The narrator turned towards the sky. And why? Because he wanted to see, he wanted to say bye to his friend who was there in black aeroplane. Okay, but there was no black aeroplane in the sky and the sky was totally empty. There was nothing there. The black aeroplane was gone. I could not see it anymore. And there was nothing in the sky. The black aeroplane had gone and there was nothing in the sky. Okay. I landed and was not sorry to walk away from the old Dakota near the control tower. When he landed, so he was not, the narrator was not feeling sorry to move away from the old Dakota. What happens when somebody is having a kind of profession, so he likes his profession very much, or if some people have a kind of attachment with their vehicles, with their things, okay, so the narrator might also have this kind of attachment with the old Dakota, but this time he was not feeling sorry to move away from the old Dakota because this time he just escaped the death. Maut se bilkul thoda bacha, right? That's why he was not feeling sorry to move away from the old Dakota. And he was saved at the same time, that's why. I went and asked a woman in control center where I was and who the other pilot was. And then he went into the control tower where he landed, on whichever airport he landed. He went to the control tower of that airport and there was sitting a woman. So this narrator asked that woman where he was and who was that pilot in the black aeroplane. Okay, he asked, he inquired from that lady. And that lady replied, I wanted to say thank you. The narrator told that who was that pilot in the black aeroplane. I wanted to say him thank you because he helped me. Okay. So, she looked at me very strangely and then laughed. That lady, after listening this, she looked at the narrator from up and down. And then she looked at that narrator strangely up and down. Okay. And then she laughed. She burst into laughing. Okay. Another aeroplane up there in this storm. No other aeroplanes were flying tonight. Yours was the only one I could see on the radar. Now she told another aeroplane. There was no other aeroplane in the sky tonight. Okay. There was only one aeroplane, that was yours, that I could see on the radar. Radar, you know, the screen where they observe the situations in the sky. Okay. So she could see only one aeroplane on the radar which was flying in the sky that night and there was no other aeroplane. This information was given by the lady to the narrator. Okay, now, so who helped me to arrive there safely without a compass or a radio and without any more fuel in my tanks? Then now, that means there was a question. Now, the narrator got confused. Who might have helped him coming down safely without any help, without any compass, without radio, and without much fuel in his tanks? Who might have helped him for coming down? Okay. This question lingered in his mind. Okay. Who was the pilot on the strange black aeroplane flying in the storm without lights? And then again, this question remained in the narrator's mind, that who was that aeroplane? Who was the pilot who was flying that black aeroplane and who helped him? Okay. He wanted to meet that person. He wanted to thank him. That's why he kept thinking about that person. But it was not clear who was there in the black aeroplane. Okay. Now it is not clear whether there was really any aeroplane flying in the sky or not. Okay. This is not clear, but it might be narrator's imagination. It might be narrator's determination that showed him that shadow in the sky. It might be the shadow of his own aeroplane, and through which he could come towards the land, and through which, with the help of that shadow, he could land down safely. So this was the chapter. I hope you might have understood this very well. Thank you very much.